Respected Advaniji and my colleagues on the stage, and the great scholars, elders, and other citizens of Delhi. And my interest in the subject of history is because of my interest in the economic history of India, which I began studying sometimes when the tsunami of globalization struck India, and we were all told that India could not be developed by Indian capabilities and potentials, and we need external trigger for developing India. This is a question which agitated me so much that I began searching for the economic roots of India, and I found that something which was not discussed in higher education institutions, among scholars, among professionals, among policy makers, among economic historians, and among the infrastructure. And this society has very little of exploitation, but unfortunately they worship monkeys and cows. And this backwardness has to be destroyed. And the British are doing this and preparing this great country for revolution. Without revolution, this country cannot be modernized and it cannot progress. Though it is a very painful destruction, it is a pleasurable destruction also. This letter, which this article which he wrote in the New York Herald Tribune, was perhaps read in India only in 1957 via Russia. Till then, it was not known in India. The man never came to India. He never read any Indian literature. He perhaps never met any Indian scholar, but he commented on India, and his thoughts, his work, and his followers dominated the Indian intellectual scene, including the history scene. This agitated me so much. And then Max Weber, he wrote a comparative study of the Christian civilization with him, how the Protestant civilization grew in economics development because of individualism, enterprise, entrepreneurship. But the Catholic civilization didn't produce that kind of economic development, and so he felt that Protestant ethics and the modern capitalism, market capitalism, aligned. And that much he was right. He was perhaps right on an empirical study of what was happening in the Protestant societies and Catholic societies. But after 20 years after he wrote this, which evolved as the methodological individualism, which is the foundation of modern political, economic, and social thought of the West, he came to write a book in 1927, The Religion of Hinduism and Buddhism. He said these two countries can never develop economically because they believe in karma and rebirth. You know, researchers have proved, the Indian sociology, history, and economic departments and researchers and universities and colleges have been most influenced by these two scholars. So this made me go deeper. You know, in 1978, Professor Raj Krishna, who was a socialist economic thinker and was also an advisor to the government of India, he was asked a question. Why India is following the same socialist economic policies as the socialist countries, the East European countries, Yugoslavia, Russia. Why India is not progressing as much as these countries are doing? He said, what to do? We can have only Hindu rate of growth. You know, this Hindu rate of growth, which was possibly a casual mention, or he wanted to escape debate and dialogue on this point, which was lifted by McNamara, and he repeated in at least half a dozen conferences all over the world to paint India as a country which is incapable of developing on its own. And it always required aid. McNamara began begging for help from the world to develop, to fund India's poverty. In 1983, something stunning happens. Paul Bayrou, a Belgian economist, studied the world economic history between 1750 and 1900. And came out with his research which shook the West. In 1750, if you look at the economic growth of different countries, China was leading with 34% of world's GDP, and India was 24.5%, England and America put together 2%. And the whole situation changes in 1900, when England and America put together become 41%, and China and India put together become 8%, India's share being 1.8% and China's share being 1.6-6.2. In this 150 years, this great destruction and development takes place. It shook the West. Many historians said at that point, we have to concede that Asia, particularly in India and China, had much better standard of living than Europe in the 15th, 16th, 17th centuries. And so the West couldn't accept it. So they constituted a research, the OECD countries constituted a research under Angus Madison, the greatest economic historian ever. And he came out with his finding after 18 years of study in 2001, the World Economic History and Millennial Perspective, in which he said, in the first year of the common era, India was the leading economic power with 36% of the world's GDP, and China too. 10th century, India leads China next. 14th century, India leads China next. 15th century, India and China are equal. 16th century, China leads India too. 17th century, India again leads China number two. The game was between these two countries. When in 2010, the IIT Bombay, when I had to talk, and I mentioned this, the IIT professors did not know, scholars did not, it was the management department. And ahead of me spoke a very big industrialist who mentioned this Hindu rate of growth as India's identity till globalization began lifting India. Then I went into Greco-Roman sources. Then I went into the American Journal of Economic and Sociology. We spoke of the export-led model of development of the Gupta period. Then I studied how the Bank of International Settlement record showed that between 14th century and 19th century, India had got 14% of world gold supplies, which means that was the export surplus of India. I was amazed that none of this was anywhere seen in the public discourse of India or in the academic circles. I thought something very seriously wrong in the thinking sections of India, and which made us intellectually, mentally, economically, politically dependent on sources outside. And I thought something should be done. Then I told Dovalji in 2006 that the problem of India is the fact that Indians have been made to hate their past, their forefathers, their literature, their tradition, their lifestyle. So that is the catch. So I pleaded with him that we should do something different. And that is where the work has been started. So it has to continue. I am sure that Delhi being the capital of India, it has so far spread only wrong things about India to the rest of India. I think we begin doing something better. Thank you very much.